that the health region had based on predictive models. I anticipated the surge post-Christmas. Have things begun to peak?
Yeah, so we're definitely seeing that predictive surge in our capacity right now. It's a little bit less, but certainly the levels and the peaks are aligned day by day. So today is a very busy day. We started the day with quite a number of people in emergency. But our world has really changed with the work that we have. So that predictive model is very important to us because we've been able to plan day by day, hour by hour, really what should be the movement of our patients. And so we are in overcapacity. We're more than what we need want in our emergencies right now. But what is different is that we have opened up and planned for additional capacity in this period of surge. So starting in late December, we started to staff additional care areas. We were staffed at regular time. They were equipped very appropriately. Last year, we were using what we call inappropriate spaces, and we don't have that in our plan right now. And so it's good. Our staff are on regular time. They know that they're working. We know that this is the volume of patients that we're going to manage. So that is in place. And like I say, today is a very busy day in emergency. So all of these different pieces of the plan that we put in place are being tweaked right now. So hour by hour, do we have the additional beds open and ready at City Hospital? Yes. At what point have we determined who's coming over to City Hospital is what they're working on right now? And that part I'm really pleased with because it's very controlled, and we're in a different place than we were a year ago, but we're seeing very much that similar surge in demand on our need.
What goes into the predictive model? How precise can it get when we're talking hour by hour? What are some of the factors that are being used to predict surges?
Yeah, well, there's a very brilliant young guy that works for us that pulled together a lot of historical data. And I think for those of us that worked in the system, we knew there was a pattern here. We just needed to lay it out, and that's what Anton was able to do. So he was able to look at hour by hour who was being admitted, who was being discharged by service, by type of admission, the admitting diagnosis by physicians. So he's mapped that all into a database now and draws out numbers. So very craftily, each day we get this plan. I've got a picture, like, and it's matching day by day. So we'll start our day and we'll look at what is predicted. Yep, we're on that. And then what the model also does is it gives us the report out from what we did accomplish in that day. So how close was that prediction to what actually happened? We're running about 96%, which is really, really good. So then if it's not, we'll look at it and see what was different, what was happening. And right now, the big difference for us in that volume change is that we're not in influenza. So that outbreak is not where we were last year, but the volume load is still there. So a little bit different mix of patients, but we're able to, that's actually built into the model too, because when that influenza hits, he'll turn on the piece into his model, and that'll start to bump us up to that daily number again. So yeah, it's very much just taking sort of some of these very basic drivers and building it into a model, a mathematical formula, and pumping that back out to us.
So technically, RUH, St. Paul's, and City Hospital are currently running at over capacity, is that
That's
correct?
Right. Yeah, we're over what we would plan for on any given day. So we've bumped that capacity up to what our demand is.
When do you expect the peak of this to hit?
So today is one of our peak days, and next Wednesday we'll be at our all-time peak again. And like I say, we are experiencing today. So what we're trying to model is no more than 13 people waiting in emergency at RUH and no more than 8 at St. Paul's, because that is really indicative of a good flow. If those are the numbers, we're getting them in less than 7 hours, and that's ideal. This morning we were at 29 at RUH, so we're over. There's too many people in emergency, so we've got to keep that pull going. And over these couple days, we know that we will have more in emergency than what we can physically accommodate in our other spaces. So we've staffed in emergency to manage that this couple days, this week and next week, that we'll be in that situation.
Is it next Wednesday that you anticipate 120 more patients than there are beds?
Yes. Today is we'll probably be very close to that as well. But we have the beds, which is different.
So you have the beds now for those patients, correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
But we're in emergency more than what we want to be as well, so.
Okay. In terms of anticipated challenges, what do you expect to be challenging today or even into next week?
I think our challenge and what we really faced last year was if influenza hits, it puts that factor in that our staff also become sick, their families are sick, and that was our human resource able to staff these beds and bring that capacity up, because that was that's the most complicated sort of clash for us when we're not able to staff what we could physically put in place. That really puts us into a bind. So that's where we're very different this year. Our staff, our sick calls are not at the rate that they were a year ago.
You don't believe influenza has hit just yet. What are the other contributing factors then to some of these surges?
Yeah, I think parts of it are seasonal. So there's other diseases that are very much at this point. You'll have our orthopedic services, for example, are very busy when people are in danger of slipping and falling on that ice that's happening. It's snowing out. Like, you know, now we kind of, you wake up in the morning and you know what your capacity is and you're doing your weather check to sort of see what kind of risks are people at. Our neuro volume is very high and our medicine volume. So, you know, those are diseases, chronic diseases that are flaring up at this point.
Surgeries. I understand that there was a dozen or so surgeries that were set for January and now have been pushed back. Can you expand on that?
Yeah, that is part of the plan. So there was less than 2% of our total volume has been postponed, or scheduling is just a little bit longer out. So is it giving capacity? It's giving a very small planned capacity into the system as well. What it's being booked up with is our ortho service is very busy right now.
How many, if you could get into, how many patients were told that their surgeries would be postponed, when those have been scheduled for, what areas of surgery?
Those ones, no.
No, okay. In terms of regular staffing, well, we say people are going to be working regular hours instead of overtime. How come that hasn't been the case in the past, I suppose? Just because you have this predictive model, and who are these staff? Are they casual, part-time?
Yeah, I think that's the other piece. When we were building this model, we were building what we call a flow pool. So there are a group of staff that we've hired into permanent, full-time, and part-time positions. They're scheduled every day, and they get assigned to where that surge is happening. So if it's happening on medicine, and we've opened a pod, additional group of beds, that's where they're assigned to work. And that wasn't fully robust last year. We were starting to put that in place. So that's been a very important part of our strategy. That group are trained to go into the most needed areas, which is great. So you're not putting people into a, you know, opening a pod, putting people that aren't familiar with the patients that we want them to have that familiarity. So that's been another big piece of the strategy to really get our human resource plan. So I know a year ago, when we're dealing with staff calling in sick, because they're sick, and then we're trying to backfill that regular time, plus backfill at additional capacity, that's where we really run into trouble. So I'm going to keep my fingers crossed that we're going to avoid that this year, that we're going to have the resources available to us.
In terms of staff, have there, in terms of holidays, taking holidays, are you still giving staff holidays during the month when you anticipate there's going to be a surge, or how does that work?
It's a great question. That is another area where that plan has really started to look at this. So if we are surging, in emergency, for example, that staff were available to work, then when their busy days were going to be. The physicians were also stepping into additional roving shifts that we had available. So it's really paying attention to the amount of staff that we're allocating off at any given time and becoming much more sophisticated. And that's probably where we'll continue to focus our work. One of our principles that we came up with is that our vacation is level loading. So we typically have been one that have given a lot of time off in summer and Christmas because that's when staff want it. But when we look at those charts and see that is when we're surging, we need to look after our patient needs first. We need to be able to backfill that staff at regular time, plan for it, and how we're resourcing, so that when we're giving the time off, it's booked at regular time to replace it. And that's another piece that managers are doing a very good job of using that data to really align their human resource plan.
So from my understanding, less people got Christmas break off than typically
what some services, that's right.
Okay. What's the contingency plan should next week, let's say when, you know, there's supposed to be, you know, more patients than there are beds, 120, what if those numbers exceed, or go beyond what you predicted, what is the contingency plan there? Are you going to cancel surgeries? What are the plans?
You really go day by day to what we would do. You really, at this point, really try to exercise all of these different strategies. Like, have we got everybody that's transferred? Have we got everybody that we can pull into home care appropriately in place? Is there anybody from long-term care that we can use our paramedicine program to go back? So that's the stuff that there's a lot of rigor happening day by day. And then if you've really accomplished all of that and you're in a surge, then you hunker down and you take care of people the safest way that you possibly can, providing the staff to be there to look after them. I think the other piece that's changed, and it's good work, is that day-to-day discussion with our referring regions. And again, they've done great to keep us in touch with how they're doing and needs to come in and who they can take back, or Prince Albert's example, for example, when their surgeon, we know, and so they're back and forth every hour, like who needs to come and who's most appropriately to be going back to the region. So I think, you know, the system is really working nicely in that regard as well.
What challenges does a code burgundy, let's say, present to you, since you cannot then take those patients back or have them send?
And I think that's the challenge of being sort of the regional center. You need to be very respectful that, have we done everything to help them? Yes, okay, then we're going to have to pull on all of our resources. And sometimes we have just more by the size, that resource to pull on for more people to come back in. And let's do what we need to get through this period.
What is the worst case scenario for January?
The worst case is that we're going to hit flu and we're going to be exceeding our predictive model, but I think at this point we're really seeing that predictive model is giving us a lot of knowledge to how to best manage what we need to.
Okay.